Hello and welcome to a special interview for The Wire supported by Glenlivet Books. Increasingly in the last few weeks and months, there is growing concern about the functioning of the Supreme Court. And many people are now asking, has the court transformed from an institution that used to defend the rights and freedoms and liberties of the Indian people into an institution that now seems to defend the transgressions of the government? And if that is the case, has the court begun to let down the people of India? Those are the issues I should raise today with one of India's foremost judges, former Chief Justice of the Madras and Delhi High Court, and former Chairman of the Law Commission, Justice Ajit Prakash Shah. Justice Shah, let's start with how the Supreme Court has handled the Arnab Goswami case. 24 hours after the petition was filed, it was listed for hearing, even though the Supreme Court was on vacation at the time, and the petition had at least 9 defects. In an article that you wrote for The Hindu, you said, the decision of the Supreme Court to offer barefacedly Mr. Goswami's special treatment of an order that ordinary citizens of this country cannot even dream of is a matter of concern. Now, normally, speedy justice is applauded. Why in this case is it a matter of concern?
Let me say at the outset that the Supreme Court was right to grant bail to Mr. Arnab Goswami. Personal liberty is paramount under the Indian Constitution. Justice Chandrachud's remarks that we are a constitutional court, if we as a constitutional court do not lay down law and protect personal liberty, then who will, are heartening. The concern is about the preferential treatment given to Mr. Arnab Goswami. Just let me explain the legal position to you. Mr. Arnab Goswami filed a habeas corpus petition before the Bombay High Court under Article 226 of the Constitution. Courts do not grant interim bail in a 226 petition. And secondly, the accused is required to go to the lower court first in the matter of hierarchy. So the Bombay High Court judges followed the law and asked Mr. Goswami to approach the Sessions Court and asked the Sessions Court to decide the matter in 4 days. It was, according to me, it was an extraordinary direction. I have not heard of such direction in the recent times. Then Mr. Goswami filed a petition before the Sessions Court and simultaneously before the Supreme Court. So in short, he moved the lowest court and the highest court simultaneously. Under the Supreme Court rules, the petitioner is required to make a statement that he has not filed claiming similar reliefs. All this was violated, his case was taken on the next day and relief was granted. I have no issue with the granting of relief, but you must accord the same treatment to all the accused who approach the highest court of this land. And you will find that many matters are pending for weeks, months to be heard by the Supreme Court, bail petitions, etc. Mr. Dushyant Dave said that the registry is selectively listing. Mr. Justice Deepak Gupta, a very distinguished judge who retired, recently said that how the certain priorities are accorded in cases involving big money and fancy lawyers. So this is my objection, is to the unequal treatment meted to different kind of persons.
Now, as you point out, there are many important weighty matters pending in front of the Supreme Court which have been repeatedly postponed. And these include issues of national concern such as Article 370, the Citizenship Amendment Act, a whole series of petitions about electoral funding which critically affects our democracy, and of course, a whole series of habeas corpus cases which touch on the fundamental right and life and liberty of individuals. Yet none of these have been heard expeditiously. So when Arnab Goswami is heard out of turn and given precedence, what does this tell us about the priorities of the Supreme Court?
That's priorities given by the court in recent times is a really matter of some worry. In several cases, the court has refused to act in defense of citizens who have been victimized for their protest and dissent, or for simply exercising their fundamental right of speech and right to speak and expression. Now, apart from the cases mentioned by you, there are several other instances. like plight of millions of migrant workers. There the Supreme Court initially refused to interfere. Denial of internet to J&K. Persecution of public intellectuals in the wake of Bhima Koregaon case violence. The, as you said, blatant disregard of the cases involving political detainees in Kashmir. So what is happening is those cases are not taken up, and finally either the government releases the detainee and the petition becomes infructuous, but the court won't interfere. The other one example I would like to give is about the 4G. The providing 4G facility in J&K, it is withdrawn. Now in 4G case, the Supreme Court refused to follow its own previous decision of where it laid down principles of necessity and proportionality. In Anuradha Basin, it said that such measures should be of utmost necessity and proportionality. Now in the second round of cases, the court asked the petitioners to approach a committee consisting of government officials for redressal of their grievances. The entire J&K is without 4G for last 18 months. 1 crore 30 lakhs people don't get. And this, according to one writer, this is outsourcing justice. This is a new trend where the court has completely abdicated its duty to protect the freedoms and fundamental rights of the citizens.
You said the court has completely abdicated its duty to protect the freedom and fundamental rights of people. You began this answer by saying that the priorities given by the court to the cases it takes up and those that it postpones is a matter of some worry. Quickly tell me, how grave an issue is this? How serious a concern is this?
See, the issue is one of the credibility of the court, the prestige of the court. The Supreme Court of India has a glorious past. It is always regarded, it is all on high pedestal, and is always regarded as as one of the most powerful courts in the world. Now, in recent times, you will find that the doubts are being raised about the ability of the court to protect the freedoms and the fundamental rights of the citizens. And I see a decline in the court's role as a sentinel on qui vive, as a protector of the citizens' fundamental rights. That's in recent times, at least in last couple of years, I find that there is a clear decline in the Supreme Court's ability to protect the rights of the people.
A clear decline in the Supreme Court's functioning as a sentinel on the qui vive. That is quite damning, even if most people may not understand the Latin phrase. What you're saying is the court should be permanently on vigil and guard. That is what the phrase qui vive means, and it is not. Let's come back briefly to the Arnab Goswami case. Even if the Arnab Goswami case is interpreted as an instance of freedom of the press, one finds that the Supreme Court has not shown similar consideration and concern to other journalists. For instance, in the Siddiq Kappan case, the Supreme Court tried to push the matter to the High Court, and the Chief Justice declared in open court that he wanted to discourage petitions under Article 32. So even in terms of journalism, Arnab Goswami ends up getting special treatment.
I'm really surprised that the CJI intends to discourage the use of Article 32. Article 32 provides a very important safeguard for the protection of the fundamental rights of the citizens of India. The Supreme Court is in this characterizes this role of the judiciary as sentinel qui vive. He says observations were made in the context of Article 32. In Premchand Garg's case, Justice Gajendrakar said that Article 32 is a cornerstone of democracy. And now the court is of the view that the litigant should be discouraged from using Article 32 is strange. But it is all the more surprising because only a few weeks back, the CJI said that it was perfectly legitimate for Mr. Arnab Goswami to invoke Article 32 against a show cause notice issued by Maharashtra Legislative Assembly. And I want to quote the words of CJI, no authority in the country can penalize somebody for coming to the court. What is Article 32 for? Article 32 can be suspended only during the state of emergency. And there is no declared emergency in this country. But sometimes these days, I am, Mr. Thapar, getting a feeling that we are living in times of undeclared emergency.
You've made a very interesting point. The Chief Justice specifically and explicitly defended the right of Arnab Goswami to invoke Article 32. As he said, what is Article 32 for? And yet, a few days later, he says he wants to discourage other petitioners from using Article 32. That is clearly a case of double standards, isn't it? It's okay for Goswami, it's not okay for other people.
That's true. That's one gets that impression.
Now, in your Hindu article of the 19th of November, you raise an even bigger concern about the Supreme Court's attitude to bail. You point out that the Supreme Court's April 2019 decision in what's called the Zahoor Ahmed Shah Wadali case, in that particular decision, the court has created a new doctrine that an accused must remain in custody throughout the period of trial if he or she is charged under the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. In fact, to point out, the Supreme Court said, and I'm quoting, courts must presume every allegation made in the FIR to be correct, and the burden rests on the accused to disprove the allegation. Doesn't this completely contradict the fundamental maxim of justice that you are innocent until proven guilty?
Let me say something more about this case. Let me explain it in more detail. According to this decision delivered by Justice Khanwilkar and Justice Rastogi, in considering bail application under the UAPA, the courts must presume every allegation made in the FIR to be correct. Bail can be obtained only if the accused produces material to contradict the prosecution. In other words, the burden rests on the accused to disprove the allegations, which is virtually impossible in most of the cases. To make matters worse, the decision excludes the issue of admissibility of evidence at that stage, at the stage of bail, meaning thereby, even if the evidence against the accused is inadmissible in law, he must remain in custody throughout the trial. And only when it is found that there is no evidence, because the material is inadmissible in law, he will be acquitted. So till then, he must remain in jail. As a result of this decision, a High Court judge cannot assess the evidence which is relied upon by the prosecution in many cases. For example, the cases of Vara Vara Rao, Sudha Bharadwaj, the court's hands are tied by the Wadali judgment. And in all these cases, the bail applications are rejected outright. This decision, I would say that it comes very near to the ADM Jabalpur case, where the court dealt with this draconian preventive detention laws. I mean, it's virtually complete denial of the personal liberty to an accused who is charged under a particular statute.
I want to briefly pick up and underline something you said, because I think it's very important. Even if the evidence is inadmissible in law, even then, the accused will remain in jail throughout the trial, which means that bail cannot be granted, and that means that a fundamental right to bail is being denied to the accused, who, by the way, is innocent, not guilty, and will be proven innocent at the end of the trial. But right through the trial, he's denied or she's denied bail. This is not just a mockery of justice, it's a travesty of the rights of the individual.
I feel that this is complete negation of Article 21, right to personal liberty. And you will recall that at one time, Justice Krishnayyar laid down the principle, the bail is the rule and jail is an exception. So we have now gone to the other extreme. Now jail seems to be the rule and the and the bail is an exception. It is granted sometimes in few cases.
Now, in fact, you point out in that Hindu article that a consequence of this April 2019 ruling is the Supreme Court has, and I'm quoting you, created a glaring loophole for rampant abuse by the government. Because now it has become commonplace for dissenters to be charged with sedition or criminal conspiracy under the UAPA. Is the Supreme Court aware of what it's done? Or does it simply not care?
See, the decision in Watali is now being abused by the government, police, prosecution, liberally. Now, all dissenters, as I said in Hindu article, that are routinely implicated under very wild and improbable charges of sedition, then criminal conspiracy, and thereafter UAPA. It no longer matters whether the evidence is weak, the charges are improbable. Once UAPA is included, bail is refused outright. And what is worrying part is the courts are lacking in humanity and concern for fundamental rights and liberty of the people. Look at the plight of a person like, say, Varavara Rao. He's 81 years old. He's suffering from COVID-19. Then the other accused, Stan Swamy, who has been now implicated in Bhima Koregaon case, he's the 14th accused. He's 83 years old. He's a missionary activist, did large work in the tribal areas, and he's suffering from Parkinson's disease. So in the custody, he's put in custody. I mean, forget his expeditious hearing of the bail, but he asked, made a simple request for a straw and a sipper. Because of Alzheimer's condition, he cannot hold the glass properly for drinking water. On this request, the NIA court gave 2 weeks to the prosecution to reply to this request. I mean, are we also, I mean, this is really what is, and therefore Bhanu Pratap Mehta said it the other day that this is, he called it judicial barbarism. I don't want to go into that article, but I think this is what he meant by this.
Absolutely. Most people would say that a decision whether an accused can have a straw, a paper straw, is one that you can make instantaneously. To require 2 weeks is a joke. But you know, I'm going to come back, Justice Shah, to your article for The Hindu written on the 19th, because your conclusion in that article seems damning. You say that as a result of the Indian judiciary no longer standing on the pedestal of chief protector of freedoms, the government has now done so much damage to personal liberty, but the courts, and especially the Supreme Court, have watched this indiscriminate and often literally violent trampling of dissent like mute spectators. A court that should be on the qui vive, standing up and protecting the rights of Indian citizens, is watching those rights being trampled like a mute spectator. It seems to me you're very disillusioned with the Supreme Court.
Mr. Thapar, in recent times, I find that there has been a marked shift of the Supreme Court from rights-based court to an executive-friendly court. There were some sparks of self-expression occasionally, like the right to privacy, decriminalization of homosexuality, rights of transgenders, cases involving gender justice, I mean, like adultery or the triple talaq, promotion in army, and the, of course, the Shreya Singhal case, Section 66A was cut down by the Supreme Court. But the executive is really not concerned with these cases, except I would say Shreya Singhal, which government took it very badly. But whenever the executive is actively interested party and wants to undermine the rights of the people, you will find the court is being pushed to the wall. We were recently told in the Puttaswamy case, the privacy case, that the ghost of ADM Jabalpur has been buried deep. But I fear that these ghosts may have returned to haunt us in recent times.
So can I ask you explicitly, Are you disillusioned with the Supreme Court when you say that whenever the executive is an interested party, the court is pushed to the wall? That means it's pushed to the wall but fails to defend the individual. It comes down on the side of the government. So are you disillusioned?
No, I'm clearly disheartened. But there are some sparks, as I said, that I felt very, very, happy when the Chandrachud spoke about personal liberty, I find that some judges are thinking about this most important and fundamental right in the Constitution. So barring that, of course, I'm still waiting for that turn of the court, going to its glorious past.
Justice Chandrachud's comments about individual liberty and the duty of the court to protect them were heartening. But the interesting thing is that they were almost effectively contradicted by the Chief Justice a few days later when he said he wanted to discourage people petitioning under Article 32. So what hope Justice Chandrachud gave you, the Chief Justice went some way to try and extinguish.
I'm awaiting the judgment of Justice Chandrachud's bench in Arnab Goswami's case. Let us see how the things play out after his judgment is announced, because we are still awaiting the reasons for the judgment.
Question before I move to a second matter that is of even greater importance, arguably. I'm now recalling the question I asked in the introduction. Given what we've just discussed, is the Supreme Court letting down the people of India?
To a large extent, I would say yes, because it's no longer that sentinel of we as it's supposed to be under, as the role was described by several previous judgments of the Supreme Court. It's no longer. I don't see the alert sentinel. In my Hindu article, I said that there is a hope of revival of the sentinel, and I'm an eternal optimist. So I hope in the near future, the sentinel will be still be revived and will be on alert.
Justice Shah, let's come to a second issue, this time once again raised by you in an article for the Hindu, but an earlier article written in September. On that occasion, you expressed great concern about the role of the Chief Justice as master of the roster, because this system, as you pointed out in that article, gives the Chief Justice sweeping discretion which can be misused, and you alleged that there are several instances where it has been misused to find rulings that support the government. Now, for the benefit of those who didn't read that September article, can you briefly explain how the powers of discretion that the Chief Justice has as master of the roster can be misused to find in favor of the government of the day?
As I said earlier, the Supreme Court is turning into a sort of an executive-friendly court. Now, to keep such a court going, you need judges who can be relied upon to issue orders which are favorable to the executive. One way of doing this is to pack the Supreme Court with pro-government judges. Now, what President Trump is doing in America, their system is very different from ours. It's very difficult in our country to do this. But like you pack the court with your own nominees. So all that, according to me, all that you need is to ensure that certain favorable conditions exist in the court. Now, these include a CJI who is on your side, or who is weak, vulnerable, or maybe indifferent. And there are few satellite judges. Now, CJI is the master of the roster. He alone decides on the allocation of the work. He would assign the matters to the benches or to certain judges who are presiding over the benches, who are the matters which are politically sensitive to the executive. And those matters will be eventually decided in favor of the executive. For example, the last three CJIs, use this power to entrust sensitive and important matters to Justice Arun Mishra. Now, many legal scholars, I am not the only one, there are actually Mr. Venkatesh of Hindu and many other, some professors, they have actually studied the judgments, recent judgments of Justice Arun Mishra, and they came to the conclusion that the certain politically sensitive matters are entrusted to this bench, and the how these decisions are ordinarily type of decisions made by the judge. So you will recall that this is precisely the grievance raised in the four judges' press conference. And you will also recall that in that case, Chief Justice Gogoi almost hinted that assignment of Loya matter to Justice Arun Mishra's bench was the trigger point for the press conference.
Absolutely. So this is, he did more than hint, Justice Shah. He actually explicitly said so, and it was picked up by television channels and newspapers. But let me just briefly sum up what you've said so that lay audiences can understand. What you're saying is that the Chief Justice's powers as master of the roster can easily be misused to find in favor of the government, provided you have two sorts of favorable conditions. First, a Chief Justice who, as you say in your Hindu article, is on your side. And secondly, a handful of other judges who constitute the bench the Chief Justice creates, and these other judges are considered reliable. And as you point out, several cases that the government considered politically sensitive were given to benches either with or presided over by Justice Mishra. And a series of studies have found that Justice Mishra would predictably find in favor of the executive. So very simply, a Chief Justice who's on the side of the government and a handful of reliable judges can actually end up completely undermining the independence of the judiciary. And secondly, they can also undermine the critical constitutional separation between the judiciary and the executive. That's a terrible outcome for India, isn't it?
So that's absolutely true. See, my view is that this master of the roster system, which we have borrowed from, is a colonial legacy, and it is followed in some courts, but their systems are very different and very, very transparent. So this gives untrammeled and unrestricted power to the CJI. Now, this might have worked in olden times, but what we now need is a rule-based or a random-based system. And such systems have been evolved in European courts of justice, for example, or European Court of Human Rights. I mean, these are very interesting systems. For example, in European courts of justice, the first judge on the bench is the senior most, the second judge is the junior most, and this is in some random basis the bench is constituted. There are very elaborate rules for the formation of the bench, because formation of the bench is a very important aspect of any judicial system. I mean, I must bring to your notice that that International Bar Association has published a paper on the judiciary in Russia, in particular the apex court in Russia. They said that the certain matters, I mean, they were of course referring to some commercial disputes, how these matters are being assigned to particular benches by the Chief Justice of that court. So we must evolve new systems, and even the high courts in India have rule-based system. We must evolve with the time. I'm not saying that every Chief Justice is going to misuse this, but surely the time has come that we should have a different system than the master of the roster.
Absolutely. What you're saying is the time has come to do away with the master of the roster system and adopt in its place a rule-based system where there is no room for discretion. And you're suggesting that the sort of system India could consider is the one that is implemented either by the European Court of Human Rights or the European Court of Justice, because both of them have rule-based systems where there is no discretion and therefore no possibility of misuse. Very quickly, I want to go back to that Hindu article where you talk about the misuse of the powers of the Chief Justice as master of the roster. One of the things you point out is that truly independent and competent judges have been relegated to adjudicating private disputes and are considered inconsequential. In other words, what you're saying is that in cases where the government is a party, independent and competent judges are not included in the bench for fear that they might find against the government. And to prevent that happening, they are excluded.
No, one of the reasons for the press conference was, and one of the grievances of the judges who participated in the press conference, that the senior judges were completely excluded from the constitutional benches, which decide the very vital matters concerning the rights of the citizens in the country. And what happens in this system, I'm not saying that is, but it has happened in the past and it will happen again, that the judges who are exceptionally competent, independent minded, and there are many, I can tell you that I see many bright judges in the high courts and the Supreme Court, but the problem is that they would be relegated to doing the routine work, like a criminal roster or a civil roster. It's not that I'm not suggesting that these matters are unimportant, but the outcome is this.
Absolutely.
That justice should be seen to be done. Not only is justice is done, that principle would apply. So I feel that it is also necessary that the constitutionally important matters are handled by
as you say, constitutionally important matters, matters where the government has a stake because the government is in court, are not given to exceptionally competent, independent-minded judges because there's a fear that they might find against the government, and to prevent the government losing, reliable judges are found instead. But there's a second consequence that you mention in your Hindu article of the Chief Justice's misuse of his master of the roster powers. You say, not only is this misused to appoint reliable judges, but it's also misused to ensure the pro-executive nature of the court is sustained to protect the CGI himself. There are several CGIs who personally have faced problems, and reliable benches that have been created, sometimes by them themselves, have protected them. Isn't that right?
I can give you a few examples. The case relating to medical admission scam during CJI Mishra's time, I mean, there was an application made before him that he should recuse from that case, etc. Now, that was assigned to Justice Arun Mishra's bench. Then, CJI Gogoi's case about sexual harassment complaint also went to Justice Arun Mishra's bench. Now, Justice Gogoi was also a party to that bench. In fact, he sat in his own case on that Saturday. But surprisingly, the order that was issued by the bench was signed only by Justice Arun Mishra and the third judge. Now, there is another case which I would recall that, according to me, the CJI should not have taken recourse to this, his own powers of master poster. There was a case, arranged suicide note, by the former Arunachal Pradesh Chief Minister Kaliko Pool, in which he made certain allegations against politicians, judges, lot of people. Now, the allegations were also against the then Chief Justice of India and the next senior judge. Now, the Kaliko Pool's wife approached the CJI for a permission to file an FIR on the basis of this complaint. In Veeraswamy's case, the Supreme Court laid down that if a criminal complaint is to be filed against a sitting judge of the High Court or a sitting judge of the Supreme Court, the person must approach the CJI and take his permission. Without that, you cannot proceed against any of the sitting judges of the higher courts. Now, her application was seeking a permission. Now, the then CJI should have simply recused himself from the matter. He should have said the next person or the person thereafter, or judge thereafter, should take up the matter. Instead, the CJI converted this letter into a PIL, which the Kariko Kulswipe never said that this is a PIL, and assigned it to a relatively junior bench, and then the bench was against the petitioner and it was disposed of. I'm not for a moment suggesting that the allegations were true, but the CJ had an opportunity to show that they are not perturbed by these such allegations, and the every case such case would be dealt in accordance with law and in an independent manner.
To sum up, what you're saying is that reliable judges under the roster system can be used not only to find in favor of the government, but also to protect the CGI himself whenever he faces a problem. Let me ask you this. Have there ever been times when you've suspected that there is collusion between the executive, the Chief Justice of India, and the bench to which a case is assigned?
This is, I mean, I can quote, I mean, I was, I don't know personally, but I can quote Justice Kurian Joseph, who said about the then CGI, that he was remotely controlled. Now, when he says remotely controlled, I mean, I don't know what else it is, except that it is controlled by some outside authorities and which cannot be anyone other than executive.
So you're saying that you do believe there are instances when there has been collusion between the executive, the CGI, and the bench that's been created.
There are instances where the sub CGIs have shown great courage and the stood up to the mighty executive. Remember the Justice H.R. Khanna during the.
But that's in the past. There are also instances where CGIs have bustled under the executive. That's what you're saying.
No, there are some instances. I can give you some instances.
So there are some instances of collusion between the executive, the CGI, and the bench that's been created. That is what you're saying.
Collusion is a very strong word. I would say that it have worked in the way the assignments are made. They have become very questionable. I can say that.
Collusion is a strong word, but there are instances where it looks as if that is precisely what has happened. I want to come to the end of this interview by raising one more issue, although I'll only raise it briefly with you, Justice Shah. That is, in fact, the Attorney General's decision to give permission for Kunal Kamra to be prosecuted for contempt of court for his tweets and his two-finger gesture. Let me quote two of those tweets to you. Honor has left this building, he means the Supreme Court building, a long time back. And secondly, the Supreme Court of this country is the most supreme joke of this country. Is that really contempt of court, or is it better understood as humor and satire, or perhaps as a reflection of what a lot of people, maybe a majority of people in this country, actually think?
See, I will tell you about an interesting cartoon which I saw in some newspaper. About Arnav Goswami controversy. There's a long queue before the court, and you can make out the persons in the queue. Vara Vara Rao, Sudha Bharadwaj, Umar Khalid, you can see from their caricatures. And Mr. Arnav Goswami is in the last person in the queue. And the cartoonist show the long hand of the court going, bypassing that queue and giving bail order to Arnav Goswami. This is the cartoonist. It's a satirical way of expressing your views. I mean, the problem with Mr. Kamra is methods uses sometimes crude language and intemperate language. But I feel that the Attorney General might have felt that this is a case of contempt, but I feel that the court should take a broader view. I'm not sure I'm sure that the Attorney General are aware about the cases of the English judges, of the American judges. I mean, they would not bother, perturbed by this kind of cartoons.
Can I?
Yes, please.
Do you believe those tweets, the two tweets I read out to you, our contempt of court? Or do you believe they are humor and satire?
No, I believe that this is a humor and satire in expressed in a way which is where the person might have crossed the boundaries. But the court should be more concerned with the work before it, the challenges before it. Not this contempt law, which we have really, it began with the majesty of the king, because the king used to preside over the court, and therefore this contempt law was brought that you cannot impair the majesty of the king. Now this is abolished in UK, in America. Nobody takes action on these satires.
You said, yes, and I'm quoting you, these tweets that I read out to you are humor and satire expressed in a way that may have crossed boundaries, but you added, the court should not be concerned by it. In other words, even if this amounts to contempt, the court should not treat it as contempt.
You see, I give you two examples and stop at that. The first is the Spycatcher's case. Spycatcher was a novel written by FM15 or 14 employee. So this House of Lords granted injunction. Now this, by the time the injunction was granted, the book was read by millions of people. So the newspaper published a cartoon on the front page showing the seven law lords upside down, and below was a caption, "You old fools." Now, after some time, one of them was Justice Templeton, Lord Templeton. It appears that Mr. Fali Nariman went to meet him somewhere, and he asked, "Why did you not take contempt action against this particular newspaper?" So he said, he gave a very nice reply. He said, he's old is a fact, he cannot deny it. Whether he's a fool or not is a matter of somebody's opinion. So he would not bother about such comments. In the Brexit judgment, the same newspaper showed their photographs, published their photographs with a caption, "Enemies of the people," but nobody thinks about the, and I'm sure that the court's majesty would not be brought down by some tweets here or comments there. The court should be more magnanimous.
You're making a very important point. You're alluding to the way the British judges have handled two instances which many would consider contemptuous of court and in fact not taken any action at all. So I'm going to ask you a pointed question. Should the Attorney General, Mr. Venugopal, have been similarly broad-minded? Should he have said, this may be contemptuous in the eyes of some people, it may not be in the eyes of others, but I do not believe this matter should be taken any further. Should Mr. Venugopal have shown the same broad-mindedness that Lord Templeton showed in the Spycatcher case?
I would draw a distinction between the role of the Attorney General and the role of the court. Ultimately, the power of punishing is with the court, and that's a discretionary power. Attorney General's role is to ascertain whether the tweets or the comments or any writings amount to contempt of court. He would look at that and he might have taken that opinion. See, there are always opinions and opinions. But my concern is more with the court. Court is
Can I stop? When the matter comes to court, your concern about the court will be paramount. But at the moment, we're talking about the Attorney General's decision to grant permission for the prosecution of what is satire and humor. You quoted examples in Britain where the authorities were much more broad-minded, even though the instance was much more contemptuous. Now, in this case, should the Attorney General have been more broad-minded?
No, I don't know whether this consideration of broad-mindedness would arise at the stage of the court proceedings or at the stage of granting consent. Perhaps he might have taken a view that the apparently this is contempt and let the court decide whether the contempt or should be punished. But I feel that we are getting too much bogged down in this contempt business. This happened in Prashant Bhushan's case, the very precious judicial time, days together, weeks together, are wasted in these contempt matters. I think that the time has come that the court should move towards the hard issues which are facing the courts and the country.
We're coming to the end of this interview. Let me try one more time. I've already quoted the two Kunal Kamara tweets that were found contemptuous. Let me now quote what the Attorney General said when he granted permission for Kunal Kamara to be prosecuted. These were the Attorney General's words. "This is gross insinuation against the entirety of the Supreme Court of India, that the Supreme Court of India is not an independent and impartial institution, and so too its judges. But on the other hand, is a court of the ruling party, the BJP, existing only for the BJP's benefit." Do you really believe those two tweets I read out to you amount to this?
Now, it's very difficult to make a comment on that. Now, the question is whether the, as I said, that the crossing the boundaries, I mean, there are some limits of the criticism. It has to be fair, and it should not. So may might have thought, I still believe that his role of the Attorney General is slightly different. He might have taken a different view. If you ask me, if you were in his position, you might have taken a different view.
You raised a very important issue. If you were Attorney General today, and I'll repeat that, if you, Justice Shah, were Attorney General today, would you have granted permission for Kunal Kamara to be prosecuted for contempt?
I have a very radically different views on the contempt law. I'm in favor of abolition of the criminal complaint contempt law. But anyway, these are matters of...
But what's the answer to my question? If you were Attorney General, would you have granted permission?
I would have simply ignored it. I would have said, I mean, there is a very nice phrase used by Justice Katju at one time. He said, "Where is the question of contempt? You are beneath contempt. I won't take any action against you." So perhaps something of that form. I believe that this power has outlived its utility. It should not be there. Only civil contempt should be there. And the criminal contempt should be invoked only when the actions or the words of the any party or person make the hearing of the case impossible. I mean, okay. It's completely, there is a clear interference in the administration of justice.
In the lecture Justice Katju gave on the subject of contempt, and I believe he delivered it when he was a sitting judge of the Supreme Court, he said he would only consider a matter contempt if it physically stopped him delivering justice. In other words, physically stopped him doing his job. But simply criticism, no matter how harsh or stern or even objectionable, would not be contempt because he would rise above it. You said a very important thing. I'm repeating it for the audience. You said, if I was Attorney General, I would have ignored this matter. And you added that the power of criminal contempt has outlived its utility. One last question, and I'll end the interview. Many people in India believe that what really emerges from the Kunal Kamara case is proof that the Attorney General lacks a sense of humor. He lacks a sense of satire, and his thinking is not in sync with the thinking of the people of India. Would you agree with that view?
I have a very high respect for Mr. Venugopal. I mean, from my days in the bar, I mean, he was our ideal. So I would not like to make
any comments. I'm not asking you to criticize him, sir. I won't respect the man hugely, but one can still say the person lacks a sense of humor. No. Does Mr. Gopal lack a sense of humor?
No, I won't say that. I mean, this is as I said, that there are views and views, and I explained to you the role of Attorney General is different than the role.
Let me ask the last question. Is the Attorney General out of date in his thinking? I mean this only politely, but is he an old man no longer in touch with the thinking of modern India?
You are underestimating the the strength of the age and the wisdom. I don't agree with you. That
all right.
I think
let's
pretty leave much it there. In our minds and lives.
Let's leave it there, Justice Shah. I point out to the audience that you were extremely forthcoming and outspoken when we were talking about the Supreme Court, when we were talking about the manner in which Chief Justices have abused their powers as Master of the Roster. But you're very circumspect when it comes to the Attorney General. Understandably, I imagine he is probably a colleague and friend of yours, and I won't push you any further. Thank you very much for this interview on a critical subject, because what we've talked about is the integrity of our judiciary and its ability to live up to its duty to defend the rights of the Indian people. And the sad fact is that quite often it's not doing it or not doing it adequately. Instead, it seems to be willing to protect the transgressions of the government. I thank you for this interview, Justice Shah. Take care. Stay safe.
Thank you. Thank you, Karan. Thank you very much. Thank you.